Shall we begin, ma'am? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So, sir, with your permission, can we begin?
Sure, please start.
So, very good morning to all of you, and welcome to the seventh and last day of our workshop. I welcome you all, and especially I welcome Yusuf sir today for joining us, and he will be conducting the workshop today. And I would like to introduce Mirza Sada Fatima, who is a research scholar at Department of English, Jamia Millia Islamia. She's the moderator for today. So over to you, Sada.
Hi, good morning, everybody. I'm going to introduce Mr. Yusuf Saeed. He's an independent filmmaker and scholar working on the themes of shared culture and arts of South Asia. His films, Khayal Darpan, Basant, and Campus Rising, have been extensively shown the world over. He's the author of Muslim Devotional Art in India, published by Routledge, and the project director of Tasveer Ghar, a digital archive of South Asia's popular visual culture. And today he is going to talk about, in this session of the workshop, the title is Discovering Personal Histories Through Digital Public Archives. Sir, can we start, please?
Sure, thank you. Thanks a lot, Sadaf, and thanks everyone else for organizing this and inviting me here. I'm sure you must have had a nice, very fruitful the last 6-7 days. So let me say a little bit about myself. I am not really a formal scholar of any particular subject that we are discussing. I'm not really a historian. I'm not into literature. I'm more of a media practitioner. I deal with images. I deal with photography images, archival images. I've been making documentary films so far for last almost 30 years, documentaries and television programs. But in the last 10, 15 years or so, I have been archiving images, images of historical nature. So that is something that I'm going to talk about, how I have discovered these archival images and how I have tried to kind of create digital archives over the years. And basically, then we will see how my experience or my presentation can be helpful for the scholars and students here. So let me start by sharing my screen with you. Okay, can you see my screen here?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So, what exactly are these digital image archives? Let's first talk about that. You know, when we think of history or our heritage, the first thought that comes to our mind is museums and archaeological sites and historical monuments. That's what we relate history with. So whenever we want to see something of our past, of course, besides the books that are available, we go to a museum, we explore what's there, the archaeological findings that have been discovered and have been kept there. But of course, visiting a museum has its own limitations. You can go there at a certain time. You have to visit a particular place. You have to physically travel to a particular place. Not everybody can go there. Museums are normally in big cities, big towns. So not everybody can visit those. And also, when you visit a museum, you cannot really touch an object. You cannot. There is a certain distance with which you observe an object. So the present day technology, the information technology, the computing and the imaging technology, especially photography and scanning, etc., has really allowed us to digitize our historical materials, our heritage, and digitize it in such a way that it can be made available for anybody to look at. And you can see things from your home and you don't have to visit. Now, Of course, we are all familiar with the mainstream historical objects like, you know, utensils and pottery shards and bricks and, you know, all kinds of small items that are dug out in archaeological sites. And we are also familiar with manuscripts, books that were handwritten, paintings, wall frescoes, and all kinds of material that has been discovered and has been preserved in museums, and it's available in the books. But there is something more, and something which has been taken seriously only recently, and that is, and since I'm dealing with those things, that is photography and printed material, printed ephemera. Photography, you know, we always thought that photography is a modern medium, so, you know, it has hardly any role to play in telling of history. But actually, now, looking at an archaeological object, it's not just that you see an object and you tell a story, you tell that, you know, it is giving a certain fact. You have to actually interpret it. You have to actually go into the details of who created it, how it was, how it came about, and how it has been preserved and come down to us so far. So the way you interpret an archaeological object which has been dug out of from a site, the same kind of standards are used to look at even newer objects like photography and printed material, and this is something that I'm going to talk about. So, what are historical image archives? So, what I'm going to talk about is photography and printed ephemera as historical source material, and I'm going to talk about how to read or interpret an image, because this is something, you know, most of us. And I'm not saying that you have to be a historian, you have to be an archaeologist to interpret something. Ordinary students and scholars who are dealing with all kinds of subjects, whether you are dealing with sociology, history, anthropology, even present day history, like 20th century history or modern history, if you are looking at political science and many other social sciences, you cannot interpret things, you cannot read things properly until you know how to read images, because we are all dealing with images. And I'm not saying that you only have to know how to read a historical image. Even today's images, we are bombarded with images all the time, especially in the internet age. And of course, there are a lot of authentic images, but there are a whole lot of not so authentic, you know, unauthentic, and a lot of fake things are you know, circulating around us. And forget about being a historian. Even as an ordinary citizen, as an ordinary netizen, most of us don't know how to interpret images, how to find images, really call them authentic or verified. So I'm going to give you a few tips or few suggestions on how we can deal with these historical images. So how to read or interpret an image is very important. Also, how to investigate and verify the authenticity of images. Once you find them, once you go to a particular website or a source or a book, to find out whether it is a true image, it is a real image or not, those are also things that we need to learn. And as students of history, as students of even literary history, I would say even film history, art history, all these things require how to interpret, how to verify and investigate the authenticity of an image. And then, of course, how to relate it to our subject or to contextualize an image that you find in an archive. So these are things that are very important, and we need to know, we need to get an idea of how we can contextualize an image, how to look at every detail of an image. Now, before I give you, what I'm going to do is at length, I'm going to give you a few examples of what are the different archives that are available in the world, especially which are helpful for us in South Asia or India, things, archives where a lot of material, a lot of historical material is available. And many of us, we don't even know that those archives exist and how to use them, how to interpret images, how to search images, and how to relate, correlate different images. So before I give you a kind of a list of all those different sources that are available, let me give you some examples of what mistakes can people make in interpreting images. You're all familiar with internet, social media, and social media is filled with all sorts of images. And we get an image, somebody shares an image or a meme or a news item, and we see it and we get excited and we forward it further, and you know, we keep spreading these kind of images, imagining that this is what it is. You know, so if somebody claims that this image is so and so, and we say, oh wow, I didn't know that such an image existed, and then we forward it further. Now, I would say that before you forward it further, we need to first find out whether it is really authentic or not, and how do you authenticate that? So that is something very important. So I'm going to give you a few examples of what mistakes people can make using these historical images. So I found this meme somewhere. It's on one side, it says a real photo of Tipu Sultan. And on the other side, it says a photo that Congress kept printing in Indian school textbooks. Now, I don't have to tell you why it refers to this Congress and printing Indian textbooks. You know, there's a whole propaganda which is happening right now in the changing of history, and you know, a whole lot of political parties and political people are saying that Congress has been, or you know, the left historians have been telling history in a certain way, and it is not right, and we need to reinterpret it, we need to talk about it in a different way. So a lot of these kind of memes are being circulated around. I saw this meme and I looked at it. I said, Tipu Sultan, how is it possible that Tipu Sultan could have been photographed in such a way? Then I went into, I went into exploring, and I obviously found that Tipu Sultan died in 1799 and photography came to India around 1850s. So how is it possible that this is a photograph of Tipu Sultan? So these are questions that you immediately have to ask whenever you see an image, whatever photograph or an archaeological object or a historical material that somebody shows you or somebody claims, the first question that you have to ask is the dating. What is the date? Where is it coming from? And who made it? And so on and so forth. So there are a lot of questions that you have to ask with this barrage of information, barrage of images that are coming in for us. We have to constantly be critical of what we see. And that's the whole idea of research and investigation, because you're all scholars, you're all researchers. You cannot take anything for granted. You cannot take even facts, you know, when somebody tells you a fact, a sentence, you cannot take it for granted. You have to investigate and find out whether it is true or not. And there are sources available today on the internet. So images, the same applies to images. So then I went into this and I found out that actually this is a photograph of somebody called Tipu Tip, who was a guy from Africa, from East Africa. He was a Swahili Zanzibari slave trader. And I found this image in an image archive, and then I went back to that social media platform, and I told, you know, whoever had posted that original image, I told them that, look, what you are saying about this Tipu Sultan, this is not Tipu Sultan of Mysore, this is Tipu Tip from some African country, and there is no way Tipu Sultan could have been photographed. Of course, there were experiments going on the end of 18th century in photography in Europe, but there were no fixed cameras or, you know, anything like that which could be imported to India, and a photo of Tipu Sultan could have been taken. So I'll give you a couple of more very interesting examples. This is another meme which circulates a lot. And this was actually published in a Hindi newspaper. It says, "Yeh hai Rani Jhansi, Jhansi ki Rani ka asli photo." Now, again, first question, again, as I said, the dating. You have to first find out what is the dating. Of course, Rani of Jhansi was there in 19th century. Till the middle of 19th century, she was probably involved in the mutiny also. And photography had come by that time. But if you look at this photo, it is a photograph taken of somebody in a profile and a close-up, and with such detail of the eyes and a bindi and a nose, you know, everything. If you look at other photographs of the same period of mid 19th century, nobody would have taken a photo like this. And Rani of Jhansi would not have allowed a photographer to come into her private chamber and come so close and so on. I mean, this photo is almost evocative. It has an emotional appeal to it, which if you look at the photographs of the 19th century, they are very flat. They are very, very simple, straightforward. People are sitting, people are made to sit with kind of a backdrop, dramatic backdrop, and they are made to take, the photos are taken like that. This cannot be a photograph from 19th century. This is a very 20th century photograph. Then I found out that there is another image which is circulating. Again, this is a printed image. It's actually a printed postcard which says Lakshmi Bai. Now again, I am not very sure whether this is a photograph or it is a painting, or maybe it's a photograph which has been touched or it has been reproduced so many times, or it has been reproduced by some very rough printing technology, but we don't know. There is some photographer, like in the previous one in Hindi, it says that somebody called photographer Hoffman, who had come and he took a photograph. So maybe this was a photo taken by Hoffman, but we are not sure. Again, as I say, that the historians have to really look at these images and say that, you know, who was this Hoffman? Where does this photograph come from? Maybe at some stage, you know, history is always open. In history, you never write history in, you know, like in a solid way. There is always room for interpretation. So maybe someday somebody will come and say that, okay, this is not Rani of Jhansi, this is somebody else. This is a photo of some drama queen or some other person. So we have to keep asking these questions. We have to keep, looking at these images and see how, whether we can believe so easily. Another very interesting photo that has been circulating a lot, it says, this is Gandhiji with baby Dalai Lama. So I looked at this photo and I said that baby Dalai Lama, again, you go back to dates, dating, you know, you have to find out what are dates. And also look at the detail. Look at the detail. For example, the backdrop of this photo, where Gandhi is standing. You look at the wall. You look at that iron grill. Was it something that was available in India at that time? What exactly is happening? So I searched and I found out that the original photo is this. And there is no baby Dalai Lama or any Tibetan looking baby there. And this photo is from Gandhiji's 1930 or 1931 visit to London when he went to UK. So this photo was taken in London, and you can see that the iron grill and that whole backdrop is very, very, English, British. It's not some place in India. Then I wanted to find out about Dalai Lama. So Dalai Lama's real name is Tenzing Gyatso. He was born in 1935. So you already know that Gandhi's last visit to England was 1931. So this could not be Dalai Lama. And Dalai Lama, this Tenzing Gyatso, remained in Tibet till 1959. That's the time when he was able to take an exile into India. So, you know, this is how you really find out what's going on, and it takes time. You have to have an analytical mind. You have to really find out what's going on, you know, look at the detail. Detail is very important, and go into searching these things. It's very important for any historian, any archaeologist, any modern historian, or even if you are a student of history or student of social sciences, and if you look at an image, you just don't believe in what comes to you. You have to question. And I'm talking about history. I mean, of course, you have to question even the media, you know, what the media is telling you today. That's another story. Someday we could talk about that. Another example, which is a very popular example, it says that, you know, the original photo was Gandhi with Nehru, and somebody put a photo of a woman, you know, touching Gandhi's nose and so on and so forth. So these are very, sometimes they can be very funny, sometimes they can be very innocent kind of images, and we just believe in whatever comes to us. So now the point is that how do we find out, how do we really figure out whether what we are seeing is real or not? How do we authenticate? So there are sources, there are a lot of sources that are available around us on the internet especially, which help us find out how we can kind of, you know, recreate a kind of a history. As I said, that you can't always go to a museum. So an internet provides that online museum in a very beautiful way, where you can visit these places and see for yourself. So, what are the types of image archives for South Asian history that are available? So, and I'm talking about digital archives, not just a place which you can visit. Of course, visiting has its own advantages. So there are museums, there are libraries, there are university archives, there are state or government archives. There are many newspapers or periodicals which create their archives. Like if there's a newspaper which has been running for last 100 years or 150 years, they have kept all their photographs and all their material, so you can look at those. There are private archives. A lot of people have been preserving things in their private collections, so those are available. And then there are very interesting auction houses or antique dealers. Now, this is something most of us, you know, as students of history, as students of social sciences, we don't really look at things like auction houses or antique dealers as a source of history, but they are sources of history. And I have actually found out a lot of very interesting things. In fact, in the afternoon, I'm going to talk about another one specific archives that I am working on, popular art archive. So I'm going to talk about how these antique dealers are really helpful for a student of history, how you can walk into even a what you call a kabadi wala or a junk dealer and find history from you know, historical sources from that. In fact, I just remembered there's a historian who wrote who was working on her name is Kajri Jain. She works, I think she teaches in some university in Canada. She has been working on this poster art and religious poster art and what we call the kabadi kind of thing. And when she started her research, she went to some of these kabadi walas and she started asking them about old newspapers and old everything. And they all were surprised. They said, "You are a scholar. Couldn't you find, I mean, in a very sarcastic way, they said that couldn't you find a more dirtier subject than this? Why are you looking at old newspapers and old, torn and tattered paper and things like that?" So, but she said that is my source of information. That is my source of research. So this is what I'm looking at. So there are many of these archives which have been made available now publicly. Now, interestingly, let me also put one little piece of information that Indians or South Asians, by and large, we have not been very good at preserving our own history, preserving our own heritage. And I'm talking about especially 19th century, early 20th century. We have wasted a lot of material and it's gone. A lot of things have gone already. But luckily, or you know, fortunately or unfortunately, the colonial rule, the British and Europeans who came to India, they I mean, we say that they almost looted a lot of our heritage and they took it away. But in a way, I would say that they also managed to preserve a lot of our heritage in their museums and art galleries and so on. So a lot of material which we don't find, I mean, it will be very difficult for you to access an Indian archive or Indian museum and try to find things that you are looking for. But it will be easier for you to find things abroad, maybe in UK or London or America or somewhere where they have not only preserved things, but they have also now made available things online, freely available, and you can access it easily. Unfortunately, in India, our museums and libraries are only beginning to come up with something like that. Somehow, firstly, we didn't preserve, and secondly, whatever we preserved, we are a little scared that, you know, if we exhibit too much to the public, it, you know, somebody will take it away or its value will get reduced or something like that. So there, so a lot of sources that I'm going to show you today are actually mostly outside India, and especially in UK, because, you know, we had the British rule and the British took a lot of things and they preserved in their museums. So I'm just giving you a short kind of list of archives that I have been accessing or I have been looking at. So British India, British Library, or what this called the India Office Library, is a big source of such material, because they managed to preserve. India Office was a place in London where they used to keep all the documents related to the governance in India. So they have kept a whole lot of material there. And a lot of it is now digitized and available online for anybody to look at. Then you have the National Archives of India. They have a particular website called Abhilekh Patal where you can find some materials. Then there's other places like Library of Congress, which is one of the largest libraries in the world, which has you know, all these books. And many of the materials they have digitized. Then there's South Asian Studies. There are university libraries. For example, University of Iowa has a library which has digital archive of South Asia. Then there is UNESCO Digital Archives. There is the Toronto Public. Now, I'm saying that even public libraries, for example, Toronto Public Library or New York Public Library, they have digitized a whole lot of material and just you know, made it available for anybody to see. Now, whenever I hear the news about an archive like that in the world somewhere, I always visit, and the first thing I do is to search for India-related keywords. I type India, or I type Delhi, or I type Mughal, or I type Punjab or Bombay, or any you know, popular keyword. You search and see if they have anything, and I get surprised and I find a whole lot of material looking at them. So I would say that I would like to give you this exercise, that you visit some of these libraries and just search for India-related keywords and see what comes up. And it's like a discovery, you know. That's why I called my presentation a discovery of material for your personal kind of, you know, it's like you go deeper into your own cultural roots or historical roots and start finding things in these museums. And it's a very exciting feeling when you find something of your own. Maybe they might have something from, let's say, if you are coming from a small town, let's say Muradabad or Aligarh or something like that, and you type that, and you if you are lucky, you might find something of that also in some of these libraries. So there's Royal Collection Trust, there's the National Portrait Gallery. Another very interesting thing is that a lot of photographers from Europe, Britain and America, they were visiting India, and they were bringing some of these early photography cameras, and they were excited, they were fascinated by Indian culture. So they were taking photographs and preserving them. So those photographs have also been now made available digitally, and it would be exciting to see some of those. So this I've listed this person called Gertrude Bell. Gertrude Bell was a woman photographer, explorer, archaeologist, and some people call her a spy, actually. She came from England, and she traveled all over Arabia, actually, Iraq, Syria, what we call Saudi Arabia today, Iran, Afghanistan. And then finally, she ends up in India. And in India also, she travels all across. And she's been photographing constantly. And this is happening early 20th century, like 1903, 1904, something like that. And it's amazing that this is a single woman traveling alone all these places and photographing and noting down things. So there are entire archives that are available where you can find. And so in a way, we discover our history from their eyes and through their archives. So it's a very exciting kind of feeling. Then there is the American Institute of Indian Studies. They have put a lot of their photographs available on this University of Chicago server, Digital South Asia Library. So there you can find a lot of things. And there is Asia Art Archive. A lot of contemporary things also you will find in these, not necessarily older things. Then this crossasia.org, this is in Germany, probably in Heidelberg. So they have got a whole lot of material. Then, as I said, that there are private archives. People have been archiving photographs and making collections. So there is Al-Qazi Foundation, which is Ibrahim Al-Qazi was this theater person. He had a whole lot of photographs. So now they have been preserved and available on this. Then, as I said, that you can go to the Christie's auction house or ebay.com. I mean, I have actually purchased a lot of historical material from ebay.com, photographs or printed material, picture postcards of historical nature. Christie's, of course, you know, they sell highly expensive things. They sell what you call the antiques, which can go into millions of dollars. So even if you don't have to buy something from Christie's or eBay, if you just go there and search, you might come up with some very interesting kind of surprises. You know, they allow you to maybe save a photograph in your computer. Even if you can't buy something, you can at least save a photograph in your computer or save an image. So some of these are the popular kind of sources that are available. There's Adam Matthew Digital. This is a company that has been preserving, and it's a very good source for historians and archaeologists and people who are dealing with modern history. So now what I'm going to do is that I'm going to give you, I'll take you to some of these websites and we'll do a live kind of search and see if we can come up with something interesting. And then we'll look at. Okay, can you see the British Library website that I'm showing you?
Yes.
Yeah, so basically, let's say this is the British Library, bl.uk, and if I search for a simple word, keyword like Delhi, and let's see what comes up. So it gives you a whole lot of search results, and we are specifically looking for photographs because that's what photographs or images that could be exciting for us. I'm not really looking at documents. So there are many things. It's showing you photographs of Delhi Gate of Palaces, Delhi Gate, Delhi Darbar, Mori Gate, Kotla Firoz Shah, Qudsiya Gardens, Kashmiri Gate, Qutub Minar. So let's say if I want to see what this Kashmiri Gate is, and it takes you to a page, let's see. So this is a photograph. of Delhi's Kashmiri Gate from an album of 80 albumin prints taken by Eugene Clutterbuck. So albumin prints are basically kind of an early photography technology where they were using albumin or some sort of protein to create, to print photographs. So I hope my connection is not very slow, but let's see if we can find that particular photograph. They usually allow you to look at the photograph in large size. And they also give you a whole lot of details. Now, the interesting thing, I'm sure somebody must have spoken about this in the workshop earlier, is that apart from the object that we are looking at, apart from the photograph that we are looking at, there is something called the metadata. Metadata is the additional data or additional information that comes up that has to be there in an archive. So this is a photograph of Kashmiri Gate that was available. Let's see the details of this. I'll just go back. So the details are that it's a photograph of Delhi's Kashmiri Gate from an album of 80 albumin prints by Eugene Clutterbuck MP. And then it gives you the details of what Kashmiri Gate is all about. And so this photo is roughly from 1860. Now, there are many ways in which you can interpret it. There are many ways in which you can use it. There are many ways in which you can study it. You can see, if you look at the detail of this walls of Kashmiri Gate, you will see that they are broken at many places. Those are gun shots which have hit the wall, or even because, you know, 1857 was this mutiny. And this photo is from 1860. So you know, now you have to, dating is very important. You have to continue finding out what are the dates when this photo was taken, and what is the context, what is the reference in which we are looking at this photograph. Now, let me see a couple of other photos, maybe. Qudsiya Gardens, Delhi. This is not a photograph, probably this is a drawing. So this is a drawing, in Urdu it says Naksha Qudsiya Bagh. And there's a little, you can see that there is a river, there's a boat in the river, and people walking across with umbrella and with sticks and so on and so forth. So again, you have to look at the dating. The date is 1820. Now, 1820 means that it is before the mutiny, before the 1857 mutiny. So again, you have to now imagine what was happening in 1820. So it says Qudsiya Bagh is a complex of summer palace, mosque, and walled garden built by Udham Bai, the Qudsiya Begum, the wife of Emperor Muhammad Shah and the mother of Ahmad Shah. It was laid out in 1750 along the west bank of Yamuna, etc., etc. So these images really, I mean, if you are interested in history, exploring history, these archives are amazing to explore our own history in a way. And then you have to relate it all the time, relate it to the information that you have taken. For example, if you're looking at Qudsiya Bagh now, the first question that comes to your mind is Qudsiya Bagh already there in Delhi, or is it broken down, or where is it located? So the first question, you know, you might like to go there and see in Kashmiri Gate if Qudsiya Bagh is already there and in what state it is now. And then you compare it, maybe you go and take photographs of Qudsiya Bagh today, and then you compare it to how it was in the past, and look at the detail, look at every detail, and it even gives you the kind of social life of Delhi at that time. If you look at the details, you will find very interesting and fascinating things. And the metadata also helps you. There's it tells you, you know, what are the size of this photograph or drawing, and what are the colors that are used in it, and so on and so forth. So many of these things are possible in this Kotla Firoz Shah. There is Qutub Minar. There is College Delhi. Yeah, so this says College Delhi. Now, what is this College Delhi? Let's see. College is basically the Delhi College, which was established during the Aurangzeb's time. And so this is a very interesting photograph. If you go to the, this is today, is still preserved, this building. And it is called the Library of Dara Shikoh. And if you go to the Ambedkar University's Kashmiri Gate campus today, you will actually find this building there. It has been preserved. These pillars are still there. So it's very fascinating that this is from 1858 and it is still preserved in the same manner. And in fact, you can go inside this building. And this photograph is from John Murray in 1858, and it is exactly after the uprising of 1857. So you can see that it's just 1 year after the uprising. So it is possible, because you know, in 1857, a lot of buildings were demolished. There was a lot of damage in Delhi. A lot of people were killed and so on. So it's possible that this building was also kind of damaged during that. So you have to contextualize, you have to find the context. These archives can actually make you like a little historian, little like an amateur historian. If you keep looking into the details of what was happening, maybe this tree, if you go there today, you will find this tree still there, or maybe another tree there, or what has it changed, which building is still there, which door is still there. So it's very fascinating, some of these archives, how even if we can't visit our own museums or we can't access things there, we can always go to some of these websites and see what sort of material one is available. There is a photo which says Delhi Bankers. And again, this is from the British period, from 1863, I guess. Yeah, so this is captioned Delhi Bankers. Now, bankers doesn't mean that they are like some bank cashiers sitting there in a bank. They may be, you know, the baniyas who or the money lenders who keep your money safely and or give you, lend you money on interest and so on. So it's very interesting photograph that, and even look at the detail, look at the dresses that they are wearing, look at the shoes or socks that they are wearing, what kind of backdrop, what kind of carpet on which they are sitting, what kind of chairs they're sitting on, what kind of headdress they're wearing. All these things are important. All these things give you an idea of what was happening at that time. This is from 1863. Now, again, as I keep saying, look at the history, you know, keep the history in mind. So we are talking about 1857, which destroyed India, which destroyed Delhi majorly. You know, a lot of people were killed and so on. Now, this photo is taken it's taken in 1863, and still you can see that the people are wearing nice clothes and they look not disturbed at all by the recent happenings. So then you can imagine in your mind, who are these people? How are they not affected? Are they still, you know, doing good in their business and so on and so forth? So this was one source. Now let me come to some other sources. For example, I was talking about the Indian National Archives. National Archives is, you know, there in Delhi, and you can visit it, and you can, you know, if you're doing some research, you will find a lot of material there. So this Abhilekh Patal is the portal to access the archives for learning, and it has various things. For example, it has public records, it has private papers, it has cartographic records like maps, etc. It has oriental records, it has some personal records like P.K. Malviya and so on and so forth. So if you can either go to specific record and look at some of the maps and so on, or you can search. So let's say if I search for something like Urdu and see what happens, if any results. So there are many results that have come up, almost 10,000 items found. These are all documents. These are all various kinds of documents that were written down in 1956, 1887, 1879. So you can go to each of these documents and read, maybe, like, for example, if I look at this document, it says political reports other than annual from Kabul, Pakhtunistan. Although this has been, the dating is 1973. I'm not sure if this is the right date. So some of the things are available, like full documents. Some things you have to access them, maybe physically if you go there. So these are some of the documents. You can also choose which document, which kind of document you want, whether you want some sort of papers, letters, newspaper articles, proceedings and letters, etc. There are many kinds of things that are available. Let's see, let's look at some other, like if I search for Bombay and see what happens. Again, there are some very specific documents that are coming in this. So, as I said, that some archives are very helpful, very, very useful and very friendly, whereas some are not so friendly. I mean, if you go to National Archives of India physically and try to look for something, you'll have to really spend a lot of time and a lot of coaxing the people to find something. So these are, so this is like one of the Indian archives. Then let me show you another archive, which is the Library of Congress. Again, as I keep saying that I will search for something India related. I search for India and it has thrown some very interesting results. It says Asian Reading Room, then there is Guide to Law online in India, there are maps, there are books, there are photos and prints. Let's look at this photograph. So it is showing you a photograph. It says digital file from the original. Let's see if there's any detail. It's a glass negative. Dating is from 1918 to 1928. It's been gifted by some Herbert A. French in 1947. Also, it has details about what is the quality of that negative which has come to them. Unfortunately, I don't see a lot of detail about what exactly is this photo showing. It's just a photo from 1918. That's it. It doesn't say much. But so now when there is no detail, it is up to us to find, you know, what is happening in this photograph. So it's a very interesting photo. It is showing you a hill at the back. There's a river kind of a thing. There is a, like a bridge. It looks like a bridge which can be contracted, which can be pulled back and forth. So, and it has these people who are holding some strange kind of objects in their hands. You know, what is these? What are these? These are like hides or the skins of, let's say, a animal like buffalo. And what they do, they take the skin of the buffalo or some other animal and they fill it with air. They fill it with air and then it can float on water. So again, you know, it gives you a social, cultural history about those times, how people were crossing the river by using such kind of objects, you know, making these hides of animals like buffalo or some other animal and filling it with air. And then, you know, so something which you don't find today, but these photographs tell you a lot. It even tells you about the technology which was being used to build the bridges. You know, it looks like some kind of a contractible bridge which you can stretch out and you can cross the river and then you can take it back or something like that. So imagine in early 20th century, 1918, a bridge like that existed and the British were creating this kind of infrastructure and technology. So many other things you can find in these archives. There is another archive, which is another photograph from 1909, which again is showing you some kind of construction site or something. Once again, there is no detail of what exactly it is. Okay, there is some detail I can see in the photograph itself. So it says native riveters at work on American bridge. Oh, American bridge material in India. I'm not sure what exactly does that mean. Why is this? There's something called American bridge material in India. So they have brought some bridge material from America, probably. I don't know. I mean, or is it something from America itself? But because the people are wearing, they seem to be wearing turbans, so it could be in India. So they are building some sort of a bridge. So these are very interesting examples of how you can find history, your own history, your own materials. And, you know, constantly, I would say that every time you see an image, you see something, you have to ask questions that who created this, on whose order was this created? Because history, whatever source of history we find, we have to ask these questions that who created this, why was it created, when was it created, and is it what all it is including and what all it is excluding? What are the things that you can't see? Maybe there is something behind this, maybe something which has not been covered in a photograph, which could be, you know, useful for our own. So depending on what you are looking for, you can find images from these sources. Now, let me take you to this website of Gertrude Bell, who I told you that Gertrude Bell is a British photographer, come spy, come archaeologist, who came to India in early 20th century. And she was constantly taking photographs all around. She died in 1926. And she was there in Iraq and other places. And actually, she managed to do some sort of political upheavals also in Iraq and other places because of her spying activities and so on. So let's see if we can search the photographs and find something useful. Okay, so there is a whole list here where it says in 1899, she was in Italy, Turkey, Lebanon. In 1905, she was in Lebanon, Israel, Syria, Turkey, Italy, Yugoslavia. And she's alone and she's traveling to all these places, Iraq, Turkey, Syria, Iraq, Iran. Finally, I see 1902, Egypt, India, then 1903, India, Pakistan. I don't know why they call it Pakistan, because in 1903, there was no Pakistan. 1903, she's in India, Burma, Singapore, Indonesia, etc. So imagine how much she was traveling. So let's look at some of the photographs of, let's say, India in 1902. Some of the photos that you see. Okay, so there is one photo of Bombay, Maharashtra. This is taken in 12th December 1902. I hope that we... So yeah, so this is the sea that you can see from the beach there. I'm not sure if India, the Gateway of India was already constructed at that time. Maybe this is just before the construction of the Gateway of India at this place. Okay, then the most interesting part about Gertrude Bell is that she is very, very, very productive and very prolific in traveling. So I'm just looking at the dates here in Bombay. She's there on 12th December. There are a couple of photos. Then there is 17th December, Bombay, 15th December, Bombay. 13 December. So every day she's taken these photographs and these are preserved. So you can see the people, you can see the details. And suddenly, so being in Bombay on 13 December and then on 15th December, she is in Khuldabad, Maharashtra, which is near Aurangabad. So that's a very amazing thing that suddenly from Bombay, she goes to Aurangabad in 2 days' time or maybe 1 day's time. And what kind of, and so you can see that there is a tonga kind of a thing, a horse cart, which she's using probably alone. So all this is 15th December. Ellora, Daulatabad, all of this happening on a single day, if they are true, if they are right in dating these. So she's traveling constantly on, you know, 15th December, she's in all these places. Then suddenly on 18th December, she is in Ahmedabad, Gujarat. Another 3 days' time, she's in Gujarat and she takes this photograph. So imagine a single woman traveling. I don't know whether there is trains available at this time or bullock carts or what, but she's definitely traveling from Bombay to Aurangabad to Ahmedabad, Gujarat within a couple of days. So it's a fascinating, in a way, a journey that you can see. She's there in Gujarat, Ahmedabad, and all this is within a few days' time. Okay, so on 22nd December, she's in Jaipur, Rajasthan. Wow, this is like really, you know, so you can actually chalk out the entire journey. She's already reached Rajasthan, Jaipur in a couple of days' time. And then, so there's back and forth. Again, there are some photos from 18th December. 20th December, she's in Abu, Rajasthan, Mount Abu. And let's just go further. Amber, 23rd December. So it's like a whole travelogue. It's like a whole journey which she's taken. Jaipur, Agra. Oh, now she's reached Agra on 25th December, the same month, the same year. So 25th December, she's in Agra. And let's switch to a few more pages. And she's in Fatehpur Sikri, 26th December. And very interesting photographs, some details like, you know, like this kid sitting in a veranda, maybe with a shoe or something. So some of these details, over 100 years old. And I'm just seeing, okay, so Fatehpur Sikri, 26th December. I'm just curious to know when does she reach Bombay or Delhi. Yeah, she's reached Delhi on 27th December. Imagine, over a period of 10 or maybe 10 days or a week, she goes from Bombay to Aurangabad, to Ahmedabad, to Jaipur, to Agra, and then in Bombay, in Delhi. So a single woman traveling with cameras, I suppose. And she reaches, actually, she is probably trying to reach Delhi in time for what was called a, there was a Delhi Darbar in which the King Edward had come, and there was a coronation of the King Edward. So she was supposed to take photographs of that. But before that, she probably reached Bombay by ship. And then from Bombay, she's going across all these places, and she reaches Delhi within a period of 10 days and constantly photographing, constantly taking the details of all these places. So it's a fascinating journey of these photographers who were coming, and they tell you a lot about the history, about what was happening in those days, how people were traveling, how, and I'm assuming that she was, you know, accompanied by maybe some security or some servants or some bullock cart or something. There is some definitely a very fast mode of transport she is using. I'm sure you will find the details about her journeys if you look at these, because there are diaries, there are letters, there are all sorts of things that are available on these archives where you will find. So there is Gertrude Bell. There are many other photographers. There are male photographers. There are also women photographers. There is this photographer named Margaret Bourke White, who came much later, who came in during the time when Gandhiji was there. And she's also taking a whole lot of photographs in different locations, different places. So this is one archive which you can look at and find some very interesting kind of personal discoveries of how, you know, if you are from Jaipur or if you are from Ahmedabad or if you are from somewhere, see how a visitor came and saw your land or your place in this manner. Then, as I said, that there are other public archives, public libraries. So there is this Toronto Public Library. Again, I will immediately search for something and see what comes up. Like, let's say, let's search for Mughal and see what happens. Okay, no, nothing found for Mughal. Let's see what is there for Delhi. Okay, so it gives you some things about Delhi. Maybe you will find some modern things. So we're not necessarily looking at all only the older stuff. There is also some modern things you will find. For example, it's a library, so it's giving you a list of the books that are available in the library. But we are more interested in photographs. So there is a way to search images. So I'm only looking at images. So there are 12 images it shows. Yeah, so these are black and white photographs. Good. So this is what we were looking for. Let's see this photo from 1966. It says fire helps tobacco workers combat nightly chill at Delhi's camp misery, except for the big tent. They live on barren field. Creek provides water for bathing and shaving. It's a photo taken by somebody in 1972, and I'm assuming that the Toronto Star Archive sent somebody, 1966, Frank Lennon has taken this photograph. Interesting. 1966, it tells you, but I'm just wondering who are these people? It doesn't look like Delhi to me. I really don't know whether this is real Delhi or this is some other Delhi. You know, yesterday somebody, the presenter was talking about the fact that you can have more than one places named Hyderabad. You know, there are so many Hyderabads available. So now I think I have figured out some other Delhi. This is not the Delhi of India. This looks some other place to me. Okay, let's see if there's any photograph. Yeah, so there is a photo which looks particularly Delhi, I suppose. Yeah, so this is a photo. It says the Tower of Qutub Minar is one of the sites of New Delhi, along with the Red Fort and other antiquities. But says star man George Bryant, India has many fascinations beyond its monuments, and every tourist comes away with memories of 1,000 incidents and adventures. So this is some George Bryant who had taken the photo in 1972. And now, what do you read in a photo like that? What do you read? How do you read a photo? There are many things that you read. This canopy you can still find if you go to Qutub Minar. So what I read is the clothes that the people are wearing. This lady is wearing a sari, and the one girl is wearing a shalwar or kind of a churidar and a kameez, and this one is wearing more of a Western outfit. So these are the fascinating things that you find in these photographs. And in 1972, how people were posing for a photograph, are there any other people available in this photo? I don't see any other person. So, and if you look at the corners of this photo, you see a kind of a shaded area. So it, that shows the kind of camera that has been used. The lens has some sort of a limitation. So only a certain area is visible. So these are the fascinating. Maybe if you go to the Qutub Minar and compare this with this photograph, maybe some things are missing, some architectural details are missing, or some have been they have been restored or something like that. So there are all these possibilities that one can find in these archives. Similarly, I mean, I'm very fascinated by the dresses that people wore, and also what kind of hairstyle. So this is Helping Hand volunteers in New Delhi's Pavilion of Caravan dish up a sample of Eastern delights available to hungry volunteer Indira Dasara. So there is some kind of exhibition. This is 1981, some sort of international caravan exhibition happening in 1980s, and people are being given food. So look at this guy, his dress, his coat, his tie, and his hairstyle. All these things are fascinating. They let you, or look at the design, the print on this woman's sari, what kind of prints, what kind of material it could have been. So you can actually read, this is what I say, read a photograph. You can actually write an entire commentary of what you see. And the details are very important. Like if you look at the detail, just behind this woman, there is some notice given at the back. If you can read that, if you can look at the, you know, like it has a menu, and the menu I can see, it says rice pulao, then it has chicken curry, 150. So maybe 1 rupee 50 paisa. There is something 1 rupee 50 paisa. So those were the rates on a menu of an eating joint that you could search. Details are very important and very fascinating. They help you discover your own past. They help you discover what was happening, you know, in those days. This is another very fascinating photograph I find. It says there is art in common things in India. This study of an old man in Delhi drinking with cupped hands looks like painting, perhaps by some Renaissance artist, but it is just a photograph. So, and this photo has been taken by Victor K. Fest in 1947, again for Toronto Star. So this again, it comes from some Baldwin collection, etc. Now I'm really fascinated by this photo because it shows it's from Delhi, 1947, and there is a boy sitting there giving water, and an old man is drinking water, and I'm fascinated by the details in the backdrop, like this iron grill that you see, the kind of a little platform on which he's sitting. I wonder where this place is and whether this place still exists in India or not, in Delhi or not. So these are all, you know, it's a personal discovery. It's like these photographs are a discovery of how you see your own city in a way. You can search for something else, maybe Bombay, and see what was reaching about Bombay. So again, I will look for only the photographs or images. Wow, I found a photo of Anita Desai, the author, and this is from 1988. I wonder if any of you have read Anita Desai's novels. Then there are more interesting photographs. Oh, there's a photograph of Shabana Azmi, star of City of Joy. If you know, City of Joy is a novel as well as a movie. And so this photo is taken in 1992 by Andrew Stavicki, again for Toronto. So I'm sure if you were to look for such photographs on Google Images, I don't think you will be easily able to find such images. So these archives are very specific and they let you see a lot of things which are not normally available in public archives. Another photo of the people. I'm really fascinated by the people of India, how they have been photographed by these photographers or people who come from abroad. So this is another fascinating photo of a foreigner who's been carried by these workers. And looking at the details, it says world traveler George Bryant. So he found it a bit embarrassing as well as nerve-wracking to be carried uphill by four aged Indians and did the last part of the climb under his own steam. At the top of the hill on Elephanta Island is a 7th century cave temple. Okay, so this is Elephanta Island off Bombay. So this this kind of uphill little road, I've been there, and you have to walk really half a kilometer from the boat to this hill. So it's fascinating, you know. It gives you an entire history of what was happening in those days. Let's see how much time do I have? Okay. So I'm just showing you randomly a few other websites or places. So this New York Public Library is another very interesting digital collection. Again, we look for something like India or Delhi or something and see what comes up. Okay, so there is a book called The People of India, which I have really been studying very closely, and it's a fascinating book. It gives you photographs of how the British or the colonial people imagined Indians and how they classified them into different categories or something like that. So this is a photo. It's the title. It says Santhal's Aboriginal Bhagalpur Hills. So Bhagalpur Hills, these are Santhal tribals, and this is how it has been imagined. And this photo is from 1868, from between 1868 to 75, sorry. And where it is located and so on, you will get an idea. So this entire book, actually, the People of India series, you can see the title of this book. It says photographic illustrations with descriptive letterpress, races and tribes of Hindustan. The Government of India, reproduced by order of the Secretary of State for India in Council. So again, a very fascinating source. This was published in London, India Museum, 1868. And it has all these fascinating photos which show you how they classified the people of India, a kind of a anthropological survey, you can say. So this says Santhal, Aboriginal, Bhagalpur Hills. This says Maliks, Soni Mohammedan, Bihar. So I'm not able to show you the full picture, actually, the way it I'm just guiding you towards some of these sources. You should go to them and look at them yourself. You'll be fascinated by the details that are available. So it says Maliks, Soni Mohammedans, Bihar. Now, Soni could be Sunni Mohammedan. I'm just assuming, I might be wrong, but I'm just assuming it says Soni Mohammedan. And this guy seems to be holding some kind of a gun, probably. So this is some sort of a gun. So again, the detail that you find in these, how they were imagining what the people of India look like. Let's see. Okay, another one which says Dosards, low caste Hindus, Bihar. So the people of India, basically, they were dividing people into different castes. So on the top it says Dosards, low caste Hindus, Bihar, also known as Dusard, Dhari or Dhari. So this is something that I'm finding in the New York Public Library. Now, this is just one book that I showed you. There are many other sources you will find. And this People of India series is very fascinating. They have been documenting, like for example, this says, Kuki, robber tribe, Chachar or Kachar. So it could be probably somewhere from northeast in India. And why they call them robber tribes? Again, probably historians will be able to say something about that. Yeah, this one says Rajkumars or Rajput tribe. Now, I don't know whether we call Rajputs a tribe today or not, but this is, it says Rajkumar, Rajput tribe, Hindus, Aud or Awadh. This is from Awadh, and okay, got stuck. You can see the details of what kind of things they are holding, maybe a gun or a sword and a shield and so on and so forth. So all these, actually the people of India was also a fascination of the British. They were always fascinated by who, what kind of people are there, what do they wear, and they have been kind of... For example, this says Shah Abdullah Subsposh, Mohammedan landholder, Gorakhpur. So, it tells us so much about our own past that what was happening in 1868, what kind of dresses people were wearing. You can also download some of these images. You can, for example, here it says it gives you the option of downloading, you know, the largest size or the smallest size. You can even order a print from their website and they will actually send you a print. So very, very useful. Okay, so it says Shah Abdullah Subspoch Mohammedan landlord, landholder, Gorakhpur. One can probably, you know, find your own past through some of these sources. Okay, so let's move on before I come to some sort of a conclusion. There is this website called Royal Collection Trust, again in UK, and again it has a whole lot of interesting things related to India. I always search for something to India or Delhi, or you might find some fascinating stuff. Okay, so it has thrown some results. It is there are maps, there are okay. Let's move on to more. This is National Portrait Gallery. Again, a lot of interesting things you can find in the National Portrait Gallery. Now, I'm going to search something interesting. I'm going to search for Indira and see what happens in National Portrait Gallery. Okay, so it has given you photographs. There are three photographs that have come up. One is Indira Gandhi, there's Indira Devi, Maharani of Kuch Bihar, and there's Princess Indira of Kapurthala. So I doubt whether you will be able to find these images just by searching on Google. So this gives you the details of Indira Gandhi, who she was, what is this photograph. So there are three, there are a couple of photographs of Indira that there are coming up here, and it says this is a bromide print, and guess what, this is taken by Yusuf Karsh, who's a famous photographer actually, and in 1965. So whether he came to India or I don't know where this photo was taken. So Yusuf Karsh has given this photo to National Portrait Gallery in 1991. And yeah, it says this photo was taken when Gandhi was working with her father, Jawaharlal Nehru, the first prime minister, whom Karsh also photographed at this time. And this is taken, photographed at Government House, Ottawa, 1965. So very fascinating that they were visiting Canada and this photo has been taken in Ottawa at the Government House. So there are similarly, this is Indira Gandhi, but you will find some other, as I was mentioning, there is also, okay, let's move on to the next one before, then there is also the American Institute of Indian Studies, which has their office in Gurgaon. They also have a very interesting collection of photographs. For if I search for Delhi, I can find some photos. So it gives you the photographs of some monuments and things like that. You can go into the details. It says Diwan-e-Aam, Hall of Public Audience, etc. And you will find some interesting photos from this. It has details of all these fascinating photos. Then, let's see, how much time do I have? Okay, let's see, what is this? Christie's, yeah, I was talking about the auction houses. For example, this Christie, So I don't know whether there is really anything for India, but Christie's, whatever items come to them to sale for auctions, they keep featuring them on their website. We don't have to buy them. They would be very expensive. But, you know, it'll be fascinating to just know what they're doing. So, for example, let me search for something else, maybe Arabic, because they're heavily into Islamic art and things like that. So I'm just searching. So some of the items may be very expensive. Let's look for Urdu maybe. You know, I look at some interesting combination of keywords and, you know, you can come up with some interesting results. Okay, Urdu doesn't have anything. Anyway, so this is another site. Then you can go to eBay.com. eBay.com, let's say if I look for Mughal and I specifically look for antiques. If somebody is selling anything to do with Mughal, and I find some miniature paintings, I find some battle sword. So very interesting things which people are selling. And even this will give you some insights into the historical. Of course, a lot of people will tell you that on eBay.com, some of the things are not genuine. They may be fakes and things like that. So you have to be careful. I was talking about the private archive. So this Al-Qazi Foundation of the Arts is also a private archive. For example, a famous photographer of India, Raja Deen Dayal, has taken many photos, and some of these photos are available on the archive of Al-Qazi. So you can see these photographs, some details of the streets. This is probably Jaipur. It doesn't have any captions, but you probably find the captions if you go into this detail. This is Banaras Ghats. This is some king. So this is Gwalior Fort. Okay. So again, Al-Qazi Foundation, you should be able to search for photographs like that. Then there is, I was talking about this Adam Matthew site. Again, it has a whole lot of research material for historians. So East India Company, you can see some of the documents from the East India Company here. Then let's see what else. I think I generally, this is what I wanted to just give you a rough idea of what kind of sources are available. This is just a few. You will, if you go searching, you will find many of them, but you have to search also very smartly. You know, Google search demands that you know how to search for a specific thing. And don't just search for images, as in images of Google. You can also search for other kind of, for example, the different digital archives you can search for. And so I am going to actually stop for a little while because you know, I would like to hear if you have any questions. So let's see if anyone has a question.
Yes, sir, we have a question from Rohan Chauhan. And he's asking, could there be some importance of documenting these counterfactuals as the uses of history that scholars like Prachi Deshpande, among others, have noted in their works? And then he says that Tasveer Ghar is an inspiration. Please, if you have time, do share your experience in handling historical documents in the archive. I work in early Hindi print cultures and very excited to learn about ways to handle the sensitive and fragile material. Thank you. And then we have another question from Saurav Roy. The question is about searching the so-called public image archives of social media when it comes to modern or contemporary photographs. Not much helpful metadata there. The social media algorithm is geared towards the data collection by the corporate, like Facebook, and extremely resistant to an image researcher user. So image research geared towards personal profiling rather than image profiling works much better. And he wants to know your experiences and thoughts on the same. And that's it. Those are the two. Yeah. So your mic is on mute.
So you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So yeah, thanks for these questions. Let me see about Rohan Chauhan. Firstly, about Tasveer Ghar, I'm going to talk about that in the afternoon in my next session after lunch. So that will be specifically about Tasveer Ghar because that is my main area, you know, popular art and popular visual culture. History is not really my forte that much. So that I will talk about that. Unfortunately, I haven't really, I'm not very familiar about Prachi Deshpande's, you know, work. In this, maybe if you can say a few words about that. But definitely, you know, these archives are being used a lot by historians and by the students because, you know, earlier in the past, the historian had to work hard. They had to really go into each and every archive physically, and it used to take a lot of time to source some of these objects. But today, because of the digitization and the archiving and making available online, it has become much easier for everyone. And also, I believe that even relating and contextualizing the objects, that is the most important thing that the digital archives provide us, they give us. Because now you have so many other different sources, so many different kinds of objects available, and they are there, and you can take a look at them and think and imagine, you know, what may be the relationship between them. Of course, I mean, this is not a kind of a substitute for real archaeology or real history. I mean, ultimately, you need to see also the object. You need to see and maybe sometimes feel. You know, even when it comes to photographs or printed material, I say that touching the object is very important. As I will discuss in my afternoon session, that I myself was responsible in. I did the digitization of a few archives, popular art archives myself, and physically handling the object and actually straightening them and scanning them and photographing them and actually feel the paper and to feel even to see the ink that has gone into the printing of it. That is a very different experience. It's almost as equal to what an archaeologist does when they go for finding an object in, you know, digging out something. So the digital archiving is allowing us to relate to things and to relate the objects themselves. And imagine them in a very different way, which was not possible probably in the past. I mean, it was possible, but you had to really take time. So today that time has been reduced considerably. when things from all over the world are available for you. As far as Saurabh's question, metadata is a problem. And in fact, metadata, as I say, my experience is that we're all evolving metadata. We're all, as history itself is not fixed. It's not something that you write and then you forget about it. History itself is evolving. Every time new things are being discovered and new things are being written down. The same goes with metadata. When you put an image in an archive, you can't just shut the details. You can't just say that, okay, the chapter is closed. We have written the metadata and it's over. No, I think it has to remain flexible. It has to remain open. And I would say that it has to remain open for even public. Like, for example, if there's an archive, if there's an image, a historian comes and says something about it. Okay, this is a photograph of so-and-so politician from late 19th century or whatever. Now, when someone else comes and says, no, I think that this can't be, 1890. It has to be a little earlier. It has to be a little later or something like that. So that option has to be open and we have to keep on improving metadata. And unfortunately, if you do an ordinary search on Google image search, you will not find a lot of details. So these specific archives are places where we can put in the details. And I would say that we should keep the option of visitors or users adding their own comments or adding their own metadata, because somebody might come with their different experience. They may have seen a particular image in a different context and they might think that, oh, and I'm talking about even modern history. I mean, 1960s, 70s, 80s, 90s, if you find a photograph.
Hi, sorry to interrupt. That metadata question was actually Rohan's second question. So my question was quite different. Huh? So you can finish
that question after you wrote that. I mean, I read your question and I kind of what sir was teaching. Because he was talking about, paying close attention to the image and like.
I don't know. Of course, he is answering a question. I wanted to say like my question was different. So after he finishes, so can he please answer my question? Yeah, because the that was Rohan's query.
No, Rohan, you were saying something.
I was just, I read Saurabh's, what Saurabh wrote in the chat and you were describing ways to pay attention to the image. So I just thought that, if we can document the kind of things that you were talking about, the kind of details that you were pointing out to analyze, to read in an image, if we can document that in the metadata, that might kind of make the search somehow a little better.
Yeah, definitely. Actually, we have been debating this a lot. As I say, that there has to be an official metadata and then an unofficial metadata, which can be sourced from the public itself. It could be a public-driven metadata. So the official metadata or something which the archive itself is talking about has to be very specific, has to be just bare minimum things like, whatever information that you know about this, for example, the size of the object, the material it is made of, the date, if you know the date. So those very basic information you put from an official point of view. And after that, it has to be left open for interpretations, because everybody can come up with their own interpretation. Like, for example, if there's a photograph of a bullock cart and somebody's sitting in it, so you officially, you can't really say it's a photograph of a bullock cart because people know what it is. But officially, you can only say that it is a photo taken by so-and-so at this date, at this time, at this place, or whatever information you know. And after that, it has to be left for interpretation. That's what I feel, and that's what we are trying to say. So, for example, as we will discuss in Tasveer, in my presentation on Tasveer Ghar, what we do is that we give that bare minimum metadata, and then we ask scholars to give their own interpretation, and not only interpretation about a specific image, but also relating different images. So for example, from the archive, you pick up 10 images or 20 images, and you put them together and make sense out of them, tell a story about them, give a context about them. So something like that. So I believe that just one single image and its metadata is not important. We have to contextualize the images. We have to contextualize, we have to relate to different images and put them together. It's like, you know, there is also a process by which things have been collected physically and kept in a place. So there is a story about those collections also. There is a whole story of how they were collected, who put them together, when were they collected. And then many years passed and nobody bothered about them. And only now in the 1990s or 2000, somebody decided, okay, I want to digitize them and put them in a archive. So now you don't know, the person who's archiving them now or digitizing them now doesn't know the story behind their collection. He or she just does the digitization and puts them in the archive. So now you will be telling a new story probably, unless you know the older story. If you know the older story of how they were collected and put together, you talk about that. And then you relate to them from today's point of view. You contextualize them from today's point of view. That's what I believe. I don't know whether I'm answering any of the questions, but this is what I have to say. Saurav, when you say personal profiling rather than image profiling, what exactly do you mean by that?
I want to give like a specific example. I think you are already aware of this. There was this illustration about Corona and a woman laborer image which Sumathi Ramaswamy and Ravinder Kaur used in their paper, and which an image which went viral. I'll just share the image. So what happened is the origin of the image had to be found out, right? So so what happens is generally when you search, when you get that image, you put it in different image search engines. So generally only thing you get is the oldest date of the posting of the image, which can be anything, which can be a blog, which can be somebody. So you don't know who the person is who has made that painting or created that image. So generally what happens in this case, all the trials failed. So I spoke to a friend who is a journalist, and he works with a news agency which dispels fake news, right? Which kind of fixes fake news, all those fact-checking agencies. So the way they search for images is they always search for personal profiling. That is something they call OSINT, which is an ethical kind of a personal surveillance system. I mean, how ethical, we are not arguing that right now. So basically, the way social media is structured, based on personal identities, rather than he started searching by the name or the signature which was there in the image, and different spelling combinations, because it was in Bengali. So he searched with different spelling combinations, and finally he found the artist. So my question here is, generally in social media, the way the image archive is designed, it's not amenable to a researcher who can kind of treat these images as public images. These images are so-called public images, and these archives are so-called public, but they're not public because the algorithm is, and the search algorithm is specifically geared towards benefiting the corporate who will have all the data and who will have all the images. Even if you have access, officially have access to all the images, the search is rigged in a certain way where you cannot find. So I just wanted your experience when you look for images, in social media, say Instagram or Facebook or other kinds of social media, even Flickr. So where the search engine itself is designed in a certain way, so that it's not made for the user or archival, it's used for other purposes. So I just wanted to know.
You're totally right about that. In fact, I have been experiencing, apart from this, talking about history and images and visual studies, I'm also involved in our activism about fake news and online hate, etc. And I have faced that a lot in this, that actually all the big corporations, whether it's Google or Facebook or all the social media platforms, they are highly politically motivated. We all know about that. There is not a hidden fact. And the search algorithms are, whether they are doing it deliberately or what, but what is happening right now is that when you search for something, only the new things come up. Older things, as they get older, they kind of sent back into their, into the sort of their own archives. So one thing is that the relevance of an image is only based on its age, its how new it is. So that is one which is happening. And secondly, searching for verifying an image is a very interesting, very fascinating process, which I have myself discovered. Like recently, when this whole China, there was this attack from China on Indian land. There was a protest probably in Calcutta or somewhere, where the protesters were carrying a placard which showed boycott China, but actually they were using the map of USA. So they put a USA map, and on that they had written boycott China. And so, I found that image somewhere on Twitter or somewhere, and I posted it on Facebook. So one friend came up and said that, this seems like fake. It has been doctored. I said, no, I found it on this thing. So this guy kept debating about it. And I said, so while he was chatting with me on this, parallel, I started doing a search for that image. And firstly, I found the person who had posted it on Twitter. And then I found the photographer and I asked the photographer that, is it true? Is it your photograph? He said, yeah, it's my photograph. And then I told this man. So sometimes it is possible to find, but it's again, as you say, that it's a personal thing, that how people relate to it, how much importance they give to it. So a lot of things are happening, but I suppose as compared to the mainstream search engine like Google, if you go to these specific search engines or specific archives, of course, all of them would have their own different ways of archiving and different ways of metadata. But at least, it's like searching by just an ordinary student searching online versus an investigation or a real research by a senior scholar. It's like that. So if you are serious about what you're looking for, then you have to use serious tools to look for that. And even Google, I would say even Google, if you use it smartly, in fact, Google has issued a very detailed document on how to search on Google, and which 90% of the people don't know about that document. And if you look at that document, they tell you the tools, they tell you the tips, and then secrets of how you can search smartly and how you can find things which you are not finding otherwise. So there are ways of doing that, but today we are talking about these specific archives, I guess. So anyway, thank you.
So can I talk about the first part of my first question?
Yeah.
So what I meant there, I think what Prachi Deshpande's book is on Marathi.
Mm-hmm.
how the concept of history kind of evolves from the early modern to the colonial. So there she studies a lot of genres in which history was conceptualized. So which she kind of posits as something which is entirely different from what it came to be known in the colonial period. How historians talk about the colonial way of historiography in India. A lot of scholars have written about it. So she traces, she goes back in time and traces from the late 17th century an entirely different tradition of writing history. And then she comes to, in one chapter, she talks about historical novels. So historical novel, a genre that emerged in late 19th and early 20th century. I think from her work, I also got inspired to work on historical novels. So I picked up Hindi for that. And I wrote my MPhil on that. So I wrote this, I saw this one particular instance of kind of making history. I mean, deploying the counterfactuals that you talked about. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you talk about it in a genre which is like very recent in its conception, it's a digital object, right? Mm-hmm. So it might not be as evident for people like me who are reading print, mm-hmm. but this might have a relation with the kind of things that were in circulation in the early print in different languages, I'm sure, because Prachi Deshpande talks about this in Marathi, and I have looked at it in Hindi. I don't know about Urdu, but I have read that Urdu historical novels, they talked about what happened after they provided a counterfactual to the historic the Crusades. So a lot of historical novels that circulated in early 20th century in what is today UP, they were talking about 6th AD, 7th AD period, 11 AD period, when Islam was kind of evolving from the Crusade period. Mm-hmm. So and their history is imagined in a very community sort of way, which is not a lot of historian would say are factual. And the way you presented those memes, I think there is also an attempt. I as a student who is trying to read uses of history in that sense that I have explained, I see a relation of in these images to kind of present history towards a particular end. And I am interested in that particular end, like the political conceptualization of writing such an history. Mm-hmm. So I got really interested in the uses of documenting such instances of digital objects and the way they circulate and the context in which they circulate. So maybe you can share your thoughts on that.
Yeah. Saurav, you have anything to say?
There has already been a lot of academic work which is being done on this rewriting of history with images, and which we colloquially know more as like fake news or fake images and all, but I don't know, I think they're like still too recent and to really understand, and now I think anyway the academia is geared towards kind of producing things like as soon as they appear on the horizon of our thinking. So I don't know, I'm not so when it comes to academic work about looking at writing alternative history and alternative fact and alternative everything is alternative.
I think I see them as attempts of a community to kind of create their own historical narrative for their own. I mean, these benefits could be debatable in a lot of ways.
I have not read Prachi Deshpande's book, but I know what you're talking about. Like you're talking about speculative fictions, and there are a lot of other people have worked on it and
Speculative
things. No, I don't think I have anything dialogue, of
right? It doesn't pretend to be factual history. So the kind of histories that I am talking about, they pretend to be factual histories. Like the meme that Yusuf Saab showed us it's an instance where they are positing an entirely different truth. It's a counterfactual. It's a different genre. So speculative fiction, I don't think it's that genre. Speculative fiction comes with a tagline that the thing that are this piece of work is telling you is speculative, right? It's in the name of the genre itself. On the other hand, the kind of things that
how a historian like Patsy Deshpande looks at things and how, like, say, but I think there's a very easy conflation about kind of the images which Yusuf was sharing and what Patsy Deshpande does. Maybe there's a parallel, but I don't think I would not kind of equate them as put them in the same category as counterfactuals, but because there's a very specific political motivation and in this case which is like very immediate and very kind of quick, and images and text work also in very different ways.
Yes, so perhaps I don't think
conflation of those two things will be very useful, and images circulate and images work in very different ways than like a novel is circulated and a novel works. And so
as Rohan was talking about the use of such images, let's say in a novel writing or something, since I am a filmmaker and I have been looking at these images as we will talk about in the Tasveer Ghar presentation, I see them from a visual historian or a visual storyteller point of view, and I have been fascinated by these images, and I would love to make maybe a film using these images, these photographs and the modern history objects like photographs or printed material. So, you know, they give you so much inspiration to do something creative, a kind of a montage that one can build. Whether you are doing a true history or not, whether it's a pseudo history, that's a different point of view, but at least they are a tool in storytelling. So, you know, we've done some workshops on digital storytelling, and we say that, you know, these are the objects that you should use. For example, the photographs, the portraits of kings and queens and, you know, all those, which shows you this pompousness of the kings and queens that has been photographed by the European photographers. So all those are very, very fascinating for telling history today or telling a story rather today. So that is what I would love to do someday.
Yeah, if I might add to it, the story or the history that you're looking through the point of view of the pictures and the painted, I visited Jaipur around 3 years back. And in the city palace, they are selling postcards. The shop is like situated right in the middle of the city palace, and they're selling postcards. And the postcards have print images, photographs of the Zanana Ghar and the women who are actually servants or concubines of the king, and the women who are in service of the male female head of the princes or the kings. Queens. So they are actually photographed clothes that she is wearing along with the jewelry that she is wearing. And the picture has been titled as the clothes, like you were pointing out, like how you like to see hairstyles and, you know, the kind of clothes they are wearing and the style they are carrying in a particular era or a particular decade. So that is how, I think that contributes to the formation of history in somewhat way. Like that history was written from or photographed to say from the point of view of a female, which will not rather make into history books that we would read. Yeah,
that has, I've seen a lot of that. I mean, people are using historical images on furniture and bed covers and things like that. So that, and like I will mention this in the Tasveer Ghar presentation, that we had somebody working on the images of tea, you know, chai. So somebody picked up our image of tea and made tea cozies and, you know, some kind of things. And those were being sold in Khan Market a few months later. So it's interesting how the popular culture kind of, you know, these historical objects give rise to a kind of a popular visual culture. So maybe that we will talk about in the next session. I think we are coming to the end of this session.
Yusuf Saab, can I also ask?
Yeah.
Very naive queries. Do you also come across these copyright issues while working on images? Secondly, do you also, or have you thought of working, or have you already worked on paintings also? I mean, let's say Mughal paintings. I mean, I find them very fascinating, Noorjahan with Portuguese women and things like that. So have you thought of working on that?
As far as copyright is concerned, that's a very tricky question. And we are all, worried about what can be used and what can't be used. So there is something called the public domain. So there are a whole lot of objects which are in public domain. A certain number of years have passed.
50 years or 60 years or something. Years
after the death of the creator or the artist. So those things are there unless someone has a copyright claim still. So then there are images which are there in museums and libraries. So sometimes when we want to print them, in a publication, so we ask for permission. There are some sources which give you the permission easily. There are some which are very difficult. Some can be very expensive. For example, I published a couple of books for which I didn't have to pay, anything. But sometimes you may have to pay a certain amount of money. A lot of archives in the West, they are actually open to giving their images for publication as long as it is for academic use and not like a commercial use. So that those things are there. As far as paintings are concerned, I'm not specifically working on the old classical art like the Mughal paintings or Mughal miniatures. I'm more fascinated by the popular art, the bazaar art, what we call, and that's what something that we will talk about in the next session, popular bazaar art.
Thank you
so much, sir. Can we close the session?
Yes, please.
Sure.
It was a very interesting and enriching session. Thank you so much. We'll see you in the next session at 3. Thank you.
Thank you, Yusuf Saab.
Thank you very much. Asra, can we stop the recording?